Welcome to the MLS Show. Me and Chris sitting down to discuss all of the results from the weekend's action. We'll begin with your side, Chris. Another positive result.
Absolutely brilliant from New York City. 4-1 against Chicago Fire. Interestingly, though, because we sat here earlier on the season, I spoke about the home form and stuff, and I'd never really thought they'd do well. 7 on the spin, unbeaten now at home.
Yeah.
You know, Patrick Vieira's got a real grip on that, hasn't he? Just a dominant performance for me. I think we just looked like the better side the whole way through, evidenced by the scoreline.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, in David Villa, me and Ped done a video the other week, and we spoke about how good Giovinco is, you know, and Ped thinks he's the best player to ever play MLS, probably is in terms of age and everything else he brings with it. But I don't think there's anybody I would rather have in front of goal with the ball at his feet than David Villa.
No, if someone had to score a goal from inside the 18-yard box and your house was on the line, if it's a striker from the MLS, you're picking David Villa all day, every day. Doesn't matter. He can head the ball and he's a short ass. He hits it with the right foot, left foot. It doesn't matter. He just scores great goals. He knows where the goal is without looking up. And I don't think there's enough strikers in MLS who know that, who can do that.
Definitely. I mean, you know, we've
without Lampard at the weekend.
That's the thing. There was earlier in the season, he were hitting a little bit of a buffer at home, and we said, I remember saying at the time, we can get Lampard, you saying, if Lampard comes back in, can he do it? And he's been key, really, in putting that run together. But we've seen different types of goals from New York City at the weekend. The first one's a long ball to the back post, cut across.
Well, it's a corner routine, actually, isn't it? Bailo to Matarrita, isn't it? Matarrita across, Shelton heads it back across goal. Easy goal in the end.
And it's
not often you see corner routines work, so it was interesting. Because at first, when he played the corner, I'm thinking, it's too far back, why have you done that, lad? And then you see it and you go, okay, fair play, nice goal there, nice well in.
And it was what was really interesting was Chicago had actually started the better. New York City get the corner, score. Vieira's obviously buzzing because they took the lead. And then a minute later or something, it's 2-0, isn't it?
It's 5 minutes, 8 minutes, we scored goals on something like that. It was just brilliant, and we just put them to bed because of that.
Like, Mendoza, I said Shelton, but it was Mendoza, but what a finish.
What a finish, mate. When I was writing notes and stuff as I was watching the game, and I wrote down on my notes, that's a left-footed Phil Coutinho goal. Because that's what Phil Coutinho does on his right foot. Mendoza, absolutely beautiful goal.
Just whips it in, doesn't he? And then we see Chicago, Solignac scores a header, Bob Markin. You think, they're back in here. They started well, New York City took over, 2-0, and we're cruising.
Yeah.
And then they get a goal, a Solignac header from close range. I thought it was Bob Markin, to be fair. They just let him run off on me.
There was two of them free inside the six-yard box again. And you're looking at Saunders, the keeper, and he sort of shrugs.
Yeah.
I've seen this too many times. How many times is it going to happen before the defenders are going to start doing something about it? And, you know, look, we're level on points now with Toronto and the Red Bulls in the standings. Obviously, we're a game back from behind Toronto. Yeah. I understand that. But it's stuff like that that will cost them, because I think they've scored enough goals that they could have put this conference to bed, to be honest with you.
They scored the most goals in the conference, 55 goals.
Yeah, and just conceded. I think goal difference is about 2 or 3, isn't it? It's just not good enough.
No.
No, and that's their Achilles heel. They need to solve that. But Patrick Vieira should be solving
that. Last week we spoke about them, you know, they were negative on the goal difference, where they turned it round, and he turned it round because of that man, David Villa.
Yeah.
And you mentioned before, right foot, left foot. It's exactly what it was, wasn't it?
Right their foot goal. Cuts inside, left foot. And it's just such a great finish.
Incredible, isn't it?
You sit there and you think, wow. And I wonder, and they must do, you know, people who go into the game must realise that they're watching someone very, very special.
Oh.
And, you know, it's not like, for me, his powers haven't waned.
No,
you know,
not at all.
He's not slower than he was. He was always quick and nifty. And he's still exactly the same player for me. I don't know whether the physicality in a European league, he can deal with that now, but I think he's as good as he has ever been.
Fantastic. I mean, what he's doing better now for New York City, before we move on, he's staying more central.
Yeah.
For me, last year, he still scored a lot of goals last year, don't get me wrong, and he's up to 18 this year. He was off the left too much last year, and he started again this year on the left, and you're thinking, people will just force you out. Gone in the middle. Absolutely.
And Shelton's been key though as well, mate.
Shelton is key. That's
3 assists at the weekend.
In one game. Incredible, isn't it?
Unbelievable.
I've got a stat there, Chris.
He's got three goals.
He's got 3 goals and 9 assists in 1,002 minutes, which makes him, minute by minute, the best winger in MLS at the moment.
you know what, I can kind of see it. Mm. Bit hit and miss last season, wasn't
yeah,
he? This season, Patrick Vieira's getting the best out of him. They're getting the best out of a lot of these attacking players, as evidenced by the amount of goals that we're scoring.
Yeah, absolutely fantastic. New York City, of course, right in there now, aren't you? Three teams at the top of that Eastern Conference. Toronto, Philadelphia Union. Philly, you were flying a few weeks ago. Had a little bit of a wobble. But this is a good point against Toronto. Been doing really, really well as well. And for me, just an incredible goal by De Boer.
Bedoya.
Whoever it was. I always say it wrong. It's him. Anyway, yeah, Bedoya.
It's that man, Bedoya.
Bedoya, not De Boer.
Oh my days.
Just incredible.
Oh my days.
Incredible.
Unbelievable. It's the touch before the chip, though. Yeah. It makes it. I always try and put myself in their situation. And look, I'm not a footballer by any stretch of the imagination. But I'd be running towards goal with that first touch. And he takes the turn and he ships it right. Mm. Now, he's not got a great angle on that point. I'm watching the game and I'm thinking, there's a little mistake there.
Should have got it out of his feet.
Nah. Again, just a little clap. This is why I'm a fan. This is why I'm a fan and not a footballer, because he can see things that I couldn't. Mm. And I knew when he was there, I was like, he hasn't got the angle for the shot. You don't take the chip on, though, but you do, because it was a great goal.
Yeah, it was incredible. But, oh yeah, let's get it right. I think when you first looked at it, he was offside, wasn't he? You thought he was offside. Thought,
totally.
He's offside. When you see it from the third angle, which is running along the line, I can't remember who it is, one of the centre-backs has dropped back in and he's dead in line with him. But to just have that touch from there and to just think it over the keeper, absolutely fantastic goal to give Philly the lead at half-time. Morrow equalised from a tight angle.
It was Osorio, wasn't it? Mm. It was his skill down the left-hand side. And then, you know, Morrow, as you say, the full-back bombing on, getting in there. Tight angle, great finish from a full-back.
I thought, because when he picks it up in that area, you've got Josie Altidore in the middle, you've got someone else coming in around the back, you think, just put it into the danger zone, and he's just lashed it into the corner, but you can't argue.
You know what, I think Philly will feel hard done to, because I think they had a few chances to put that game to bed, to be honest with you. Is it Irwin, Toronto's goalkeeper?
Irwin.
Makes a great save right at the back end of the first half, doesn't he? Keeps them at 1-0. Great job by the goalkeeper. Yeah, exactly. And then actually at the end of the game, Toronto would have been feeling a little bit hard done to. Because Altidore, he was fouled in the box, mate.
Fouled for the, yeah.
93rd minute or something. And he's taken out. And look, there's not a lot of contact on that. But the guy is, he's gone in front of his man, Altidore. Mm. And the guy's come into the back of him.
Yeah.
And he goes down. That's a penalty for me.
Yeah. And he'd already been unlucky at the post, didn't he? As it comes back, he just can't get his foot round it. And I was fuming because he was in our MLS Show League. He was my wild card to get.
Was he?
Only basically just to troll Ped, because Ped's destroyed him all year. And he's been banging goals in every week. So every week I just do Josie now. And he's been come good for me. But almost won it. But that keeps them nicely placed, doesn't it? Toronto, of course, joint top on 48. Philly on 42, and you're still looking, I mean, where they are now, they're what, 6 points still ahead of the Rebs, looking at, what are we on, they've got 3 games to go after the Rebs have. You'd expect them there now, wouldn't you? Philadelphia Union safe?
Yeah, I think 42. So. I think so, mate, yeah, I would say so.
I think so.
You just think it's going to win it?
You know what, I sat here, in fact, it was when we were on the Ball Street Social Club, first one we'd done, and Paul asked who did I think would win MLS Cup, and I said Toronto, because I thought he'd have a big season, and he didn't start great, and I was thinking, I was way off, but they're right in there, they look a good bet for me, because if Giovinco comes back fresh, coming into these players, they've got a shout, but I think Dallas have been outstanding all season, but you know what, mate, I think Lampard and New York City are a shout as well.
They can beat anyone on the day.
It's open.
I think there's a few teams like that, isn't
for it? Me, I think it's more open this year than it's been for a few years. Yeah. I really do, because I think the Red Bulls are strong, Toronto are strong, New York City, you've got Dallas in the other one, you'd never rule Galaxy out of it. So you just...
It was interesting even going back a few weeks and we were looking at the two conferences and everyone's going, the Western Conference is by far the strongest and stuff. And even now, I think it's evened itself out a little bit over the course of the season. I think there are still some good sides in that Western Conference, but the Eastern Conference teams are starting to step up as well, and they're gaining a lot of points. Because I think there's only about, what is it, FC Dallas on about 53 points, something 50 like that.
I think it's 50 something.
New
yeah.
York, Toronto, New York City. Sorry, Red Bull, Toronto, and New York City. They're all on like 48. That's just, they're a massive so point themselves,
yeah.
right?
Yeah, they're doing really well. Moving on, we'll go over to that the Western Conference, Vancouver 3, yeah. Colorado Rapids 3. This was a great game. I'm probably a little bit critical of Colorado's goalkeeper at times.
Yeah.
For us, I just one of the goals in this one.
Is it the one that he's diving backwards into the net for?
Yeah, the second goal. Chance? Yeah. I honestly don't know what
he's doing.
I've seen that a few times for Evan. He had no. Look, I don't blame him for the first goal he conceded was a header from close range. Washington couldn't do anything about that. And the third goal is a header from close range. But the second one, Morales, I think it is.
Their first one was the one that came from the corner.
That was the equaliser. Obviously, Rapids went ahead. Lovely little ball over the top. Hairston does absolutely brilliant.
Yeah,
gets taken out by the goalie. But Badgie's there and he knocks it in the net. And Colorado have been brilliant all season, haven't they? They're a goal up.
It's the equalising goal, isn't it, for 1-1?
That's Washington
and,
off the header.
And you look at that, I'm just calling it old-fashioned or whatever. Like, I know Howard's not to blame, but equally, I kind of want my keeper to do something.
He stands on his line, doesn't he? I've seen Afrin Tim. I don't know whether he's not really a goalie that's going to come through traffic. I think as he's got older, he's kind of... rooted on his goal line. I kind of see what you're saying, but I think I still think Washington's a big, powerful centre back, but he's just got to run on people and he's got the header in. And you know, you want one, but then for me, it's goal of the weekend, I think. But we'll come to that later.
Penalty.
The free. No, mate. Oh, Shelton. Let's talk about Shelton's free kick.
Okay.
Let's talk about that one.
Okay.
Forget the pen.
Look, that goal, and the commentators said the Wolves' position's wrong.
Okay.
Right? Nah. Sorry, it's not. The Wolves in the right place. He bends that ball. You couldn't have walked up and put that better in the goal. Literally, he bends it round. And I probably couldn't slam dunk it into that corner. I'm not sure. You know what I mean? And you're watching it and you're like, it's in. There's no stopping that. That is in. What a
incredible penalty. Absolutely. I mean, his penalty was brilliant, you know. He slotted it in quite confidently, but that free kick, the whip and bend on it was just unbelievable. From behind the goal, he's hit it out wide and it comes back in. It was absolutely top class. And he's been hit and miss for Colorado this year because he scored a lot of goals in the Swiss League, but that was just, for me, was absolutely brilliant.
Which you can find out about on the Swiss League show run by Barry.
I was pleased to see Giles Barnes have an assist for Vancouver's second goal, because he's moved from Houston. He's not really pulled up any trees of Vancouver, but that was what he's about. Nice and pacey and direct. Lovely little ball across Brazales.
Sloppy defender still.
Oh, poor defender, but you know, you want your centre forward, or you want your forward players like Barnes to commit defenders, and that's what he's done. And then obviously the third goal, you know, a header from close range from Hurtado, I think it was, drags it back late on. You know, not like Tim to concede the 94th minute goal or something like that. But that ended 3-3. Just looking at that league table, Colorado still in second place on 48 points. Vancouver have been very disappointing this season.
Colorado will be gutted there. I've been led three times.
Oh, God, yeah.
They should be, for me, they should be 3 points behind FC Dallas now with two games in hand. And look, that is a much better situation than 5 points with two games in hand. Because at this point, I'd rather be FC Dallas with the points in the bag, to be honest with you. The Rapids, they should be really annoyed with themselves.
Yeah.
And hopefully that won't cause much of a hangover to them. I hope that doesn't sort of derail them and you know, that squad unity and stuff.
Yeah.
Hopefully they can keep going. But that's a big loss to them, I think. I think it could bear fruit come the end of the season.
Definitely, those 2 points frustrating. I mean, one more before we move on, one more thing about Tim Howard. He tweeted before the game, it's our last game of the regular season. It was the 29th game. People didn't tell Tim there's 34 games in the regular season. Tim, maybe, do your homework.
Maybe son. He just was thinking, if I play really badly here,
I might play, it might be my last game, because Zach McMath, who was in before Howard came and was actually brilliant for Colorado, could be getting a little shout before the end.
Yeah.
Moving on to
your teammate.
My team, yeah. Let's skate over this one very quickly. Yeah. Now, DC United 4, Orlando City 1. I watched this, it was Groundhog Day at 2 o'clock in the morning for me. Just can't stop conceding goals. Got through to about half an hour, then Patrick Mullen scores, and we just literally just all over the place defensively.
Yeah,
you know,
it was a lovely. It was the back heel that broke that move, wasn't it?
Yeah,
you know, and that little back heel inside the box and it comes across, and then after that it's really easy. But I think that back heel, I don't know, I felt like I watched your team crumble at that point.
Yeah.
Like they just thought, we're done, we're going to concede all of the goals here. And then after that, they kind of mullered you, mate.
1-0, you know, doing well for half an hour, keep it nice and tight for half an hour, go behind, get in at half time. Jason Christ be thinking, right, let's get organised. First 15 minutes, get out there, keep it nice and tight, grow into this game, come out, goal, 3-0 down. And it's like, for me, I said this on Saturday, and some people took issue with it. Some Orlando City fans got no problem with that. It, football's about opinions, isn't it? What's frustrating me at the moment with Orlando City, I'm not leaving this at Jason Christ's door, but when Adrian Heath was in charge, they conceded goals exactly the same, get me wrong, but we were much better in the final third. We scored a lot as well. Now, Christ has got to address this very quickly, trying to change it, and if, to be honest with you, we probably won't see it until next season, not with Orlando City. But that's three games on the run. We've conceded four goals. Having beat Montreal 4-1 away, we then have lost the next three by four goals. You can't keep doing it.
No, you can't. And that's why your goal difference is now at -8, isn't it? You know, before though that run of games, you were in a positive goal difference. It kind of proves your point. You were scoring goals, you were conceding goals. It was very close to being equal. But now, it just feels like the opposition team's not working hard enough to score.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is, mate. And I think there's, for me, a few months ago, we had Rafa Ramos at right back, we had Seren and Nagita, who were like, they do concede a lot of yellow cards and free kicks, but they were little dogs in the midfield. I watched that midfield Saturday, Higuita was on the bench, he had Nocerino in there, Nocerino. You know, want him to stay disciplined, he's Italian, he's played for Milan, he's throwing elbows around and getting sent off, and he's not helping anybody.
No, he's got to be a better professional than that, you hasn't know. He's been around, like, you know what I mean?
Just think.
The shining light, Baptista's free kick was a belter, mate.
There's a screamer.
It just looks better when it goes off the bar, doesn't it?
And at the dick. The dick was just beautiful.
Because it was inside the D.
Yeah.
Wasn't it inside the 18-yard box?
Well, he wanted the penalty for the foul, he was out. He wasn't.
Normally, you said, at that point, the commentator's first port of call, if it's a Premier League game, is difficult to get it up and down for me. Yeah. Bam! Straight in. Off the crossbar. And you're like, what a hit, son.
And then we hit the bar just straight after the Carl Laren smashes the underside of the bar. Quite interestingly, Christ gave it up very early. Half an hour to go, Kaká had gone off. He took Laren off. As if to say, we've got a game Wednesday night, you know, this is done. And it was that probably our best spell in the game. We'd scored, we did the bar. They were rocking a little bit. Once that went off, the threat went then. And DC fully deserved the 3 points and got the, what was his name, Boucher, got his first MLS goal. He's last in the fourth at the end, but a great win for DC United. That gets them into the playoffs now above the Rebs. Orlando City, of course, just one win outside the playoffs. Them three, we talked about it last week, they're the ones who are vying for that final place. But although saying that, Montreal Impact, they are in a downward spiral at the moment. They're only on 38 points.
Yeah,
so
they're not doing great at the minute, are they?
They could be dragged on. Let's go on to one. It leads us seamlessly. See that link? Seamlessly.
That, beautiful.
Onto the Red Bull. We will change the shirt sometimes, but Red Bulls deserve it because they've got the victory at the weekend, and it's the first time this season that Red Bulls have been top of the Eastern Conference.
Wow, okay. Wow.
Bottom in April. Lost 6 of the first 7.
It's a great turnaround, isn't it, to be honest with you? No, look, they dogged out a win there, didn't they? And that's what they have to do. And that's how you get to the top of league tables, isn't it? You've got to beat teams when you're playing badly and stuff like that. New York Red Bulls have done that. And it was a real pressure point for them, I felt, this last weekend. And they've come out of it.
Piatti's missed a couple of good chances.
I thought Piatti looked really good.
I was really absolutely brilliant. But there was one he broke through with Drogba, and Drogba was just give it to Drogba, and he's took the extra touch.
He slots
it wide in the end, and he just squared it. The other one he was unlucky when he danced around, and the keeper's made a good save. But You know, it was a goal from Royer, wasn't it, about the hour mark?
Yeah, his first goal for Rebels as well, wasn't it?
Just got them over the line, but that's what they're fantastic at. They're well organised. They can grind out them results, and it's the 11th home victory of the season, so you can't argue with that. Top, like I said, top of the Eastern Conference for the first time this season. Incredible. Moving on, Houston Dynamo 3, Portland Timbers 1. This one, Minotas with a hat-trick, penalty kick, and done really well, the young kid. You know, Houston have had a real upsurge in form since Owen Coyle left, quite ironically. Yeah. Now, they started getting some results.
Doesn't surprise me, to be honest, mate.
Blackburn aren't exactly pulling up any trees either, are they, in the championship? Great results, Portland Timbers. Liam Ridgewell gives a penalty away, and that gives Houston, you know, the impetus to take the lead. Valeri equalised from close range for Timbers second half, but Minotas just powers it away, and it's a really, really good result because Dynamo were adrift a while ago, adrift at the bottom of the Western Conference. You look, and now the 2 points behind, you know, a win off Vancouver Whitecaps, yeah. who have, you know, and the two behind San Jose.
Where's it all going wrong for Portland, though, Bas?
You know what, mate? They're in. This is what they were like last season, and he went on to win it. But last season, they just got the little bit of momentum those last couple of weeks, and they took the last day. He took San Jose's place into the playoff, and he went on and won it. I think this year they've had Ridgewell out for a while. They've had Borges, who was big for them, out for a while. Ridgey's come back in. He's trying to get a new partnership going with Stephen Taylor from Newcastle, and they're just struggling. I mean, away from home, they haven't won a single game, Chris. The home form, 11 victories. Away from home, 8-9 losses on the road, 6 ties. They win 2 away games there. They're on 47 points, they're in 4th.
Yeah.
And that's where it's going wrong. Away from home, they just haven't been good enough. And they win again at the weekend in Houston.
Can you see them turn it round?
I think the home form, it's... I'd fear for them now because I think Seattle have got momentum. And me and Ped have always, and you will know this now watching it this season, momentum is everything. You know it in the Premier League, you know it a couple of years ago when Liverpool nearly won it.
It's the momentum thing really helps when it comes to the playoffs and stuff like that.
I watch it with the NFL,
mate. I'm watching Baltimore Ravens a few years ago from going from the wild card all the way through to win the Super Bowl. It's like a groundswell, isn't it, sometimes? Yeah. And these teams start to believe that they're not going to get beaten and stuff, and it's always a worry the other way around.
It's fans, though, isn't it? It's confidence. Fans are doing the exact same thing. Fans are going, feel confident today, we feel good today. And that buzz around the stadium, you get in, it transcends to the players, and they get over the line. And I think that's why I think Seattle have got the momentum. Portland, they can still do it. Listen, the one win away, you know, there's a couple of teams in there.
Yeah.
Real Salt Lake have been excellent all season. Portland are 4 points behind them, so it's going to be tight for them. But you just look at Seattle, got 2 games in hand on Portland Timbers. They win them 2.
Yeah.
They're 3 points ahead of them, so Portland could slip up. Let's go on to Seattle, because I've mentioned them a couple of times there. They went to Galaxy. This one was a shock result for me, because even though, like I say, Siggy Schmidt got moved out of Seattle, since then they've got Nicholas Ladero in. He's been called up to the Uruguay national squad now, just had some fantastic performance. And they've had a real upsurge in form. Jordan Morris, you mentioned last week, had scored and winning goals, and he was at it again this weekend. And, you know, they went behind,
yeah,
didn't he? They fell Robbie behind. Keane, Robbie Keane, the header, from great ball in from the jet. Lovely ball in, great header from Robbie
Keane. It's his movement in the box, isn't
yeah.
it? Just, you know, he just drifts off the back of the centre-back, creates himself a little bit of space, and he can head the ball
Robbie Keane. And Dos Santos misses a big chance for 2-0. Go down the other end. Van Damme on goal. And the game swings. And there was one, we move into the second half, and the game's tied at 1-1. And I've looked on some of the discussion boards, MLS discussion boards. Few people feeling Jordan Morris's first goal was a foul.
Nah.
Which Steris.
Sod off. Sorry, no.
Was it?
Nah, he just beats over him, mate. Mm. Absolutely.
Steris goes for him first, and he just...
Yeah.
It's just strength and pace, isn't
fine.
It? And,
yeah. Look, that is not a foul. No. If we're watching football and you want to be taken seriously, that's not a foul.
No, it's not, is it? And what a finish.
The pace of that.
The pace, he just got his head down.
And yeah, you're right.
Outside his foot. Beautiful, wasn't it?
Right. Outside the boots.
You know, he puts them 2-1 up. Then he's in the right place at the right time. They have a great little move again. Ladero sent it to him.
He's involved, isn't he? Yeah.
He's involved there. Comes out to him earlier in the season. he snatches at that. Snatches at it. This time, just shifts it onto the left foot and passes it in. It's a nice finish.
It's really composed, actually, isn't it? Yeah. It's those types of finishes for me. I enjoy watching strikers do that. When it's so crowded in that area and there's not a lot of time, to be able to take a touch and realise how much time you've got is a skill, and it's an underrated skill in strikers.
Definitely. Slotted in 3-1. That takes him up to 12 goals now, which is the second best ever for a rookie.
Brilliant.
So absolutely fantastic. The fourth goal's a beautiful goal from Alonso. Just stays hit.
It's still going now, mate. It's still going. You know what though? If I was a Galaxy fan and I'm a Steven Gerrard fan, I'm a little bit disappointed with what he did in the build-up to that goal, to be honest with you, mate. You know, I know it goes off the referee. It bounces off the referee in
nice
the build-up, doesn't it? But I'd be looking at, he's not even made an attempt to track back.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying he could have got him.
Mm.
But what I want to see is, I want to see all my players all the time giving 110%.
Yeah.
And for me, Gerrard just wasn't asked about getting back for that. And that's what I saw last season at Liverpool. And it's like, whether he's got the legs to do it is here or there.
Yeah, yeah.
Whether you got the legs or not, you can still flip and try. Yeah. And I'd be a little bit annoyed. But I think he makes up for it.
I was going to say, to be fair, he had the legs a little bit going the other way, didn't he?
Yeah, he did.
Racing into the box.
Bursting in and getting penned. I was just saying that.
People said that. I don't know whether it was Lexi Layla doing a commentary I was listening to. He'd done the Columbus game. It's been Taylor Twelman said it wasn't a penalty on Gerrard.
It was a penalty, wasn't it? Tell him to shut up. If you know him, tell him to shut up.
I'll just tweet him. It was a push. It was a penalty.
Don't give him no context.
No.
Just say shut up.
Shut up, lad. And obviously Robbie Keane slotted beautifully. Just a side note to that. A great, fantastic win for Seattle Sounders. They bang themselves right into the mix now. And like we say, those, if they can win their two games in hand, they're comfortably in that playoff position. Just very quickly, Bruce Arena said yesterday, unsure on, but no decision will be made on Robbie Keane and Steven Gerrard till the close season. Sensible?
I think so, yeah. You've got to see what. Maybe the Steven Gerrard one.
Yeah.
I'd probably be looking to tie up Robbie Keane.
I'd be getting Keane straight away, because I don't think he's ready to pack in, and I think there's quite a few MLS clubs, Orlando City, that would take Robbie Keane if he's going. So I think, Gerrard, I'm not sure. He was retiring, then he might do another year, not sure, but I'm 100% with you. Robbie Keane, tie him up immediately. Real Salt Lake, nil, FC Dallas, nil. We're not going to go on about this one. Decent point for Dallas, keep that momentum going, unbeaten. Real Salt Lake probably wanted the 3 points given it was a home game. But, you know, what I saw of it, I think Dallas had good chances to win it. But a point apiece, keep them both ticking over as we move forward. 3 games to go in that. San Jose 1, Sporting Kansas City 2. Peds team getting a big win. It was a Liverpool fan, Dom Dwyer, with a close-range header to give Sporting the lead. It was a nice header. Lovely ball to the back post. And that's what Dwyer does. He's a little aggressive, angry, young, bustling striker. Nice little goal from him. Dawkins, the ex-Derby County player, level from a close-range for San Jose. And Kevin Ellis with a strange winner. I'm going to say he meant the back heel. I think the ball just dropped. I think the ball just dropped and he's just gone like that and it went in.
Okay.
But why would you do that action? Because the ball comes, it's like a weird action to back heel it in. It's a little bit. Anyway, he got the win for Sporting Kansas City, which, you know, puts them 5 ahead of Sounders. But Sounders can even go ahead of Sporting if they win the 2 games in hand. So they're going to be key in that. San Jose are just. They surely, you know, they're planning for next season. And the final one of the week was Columbus Crew 2, New England Revolution 0. I watched this last night. It was a battle of the Kamaras. Kai Kamara didn't have a very good day. Ola Kamara had a very good day. Scored both goals. I think that's 14 or 15 now for the season for Ola Kamara. And he's been a fantastic replacement, of course, for Kai. Columbus Crew, you know, finalists last year. Got themselves off the bottom of the table with that result. They've been very disappointing this year.
Look, they have. Of course they have. But what Columbus Crew have got going for them is great shirts and fanwear. And all the merchandise is spot on. The colour scheme, the yellow, the black, it's beautiful stuff.
You love it?
I do. I genuinely do. I think it's really classy. The team... Not so.
Yeah, I mean, last year, sometimes you can have this. Me and Ped spoke last week about it. Me and you done the video about the Kai Kamara penalty situation very early on, and he messaged us, remember, and he wasn't too happy that we'd said things. But a lot of things.
Which you still never told me about. He said,
I keep telling you, he messaged us yet and I haven't showed you. I'm going to show you in a minute. But he wasn't too happy about it. But a lot of things I think have stemmed from. I don't think he's had the greatest season at the Reds as a result. Even Columbus Crew missed them, even though Kamara's been banging, the other Kamara's been scoring. It's been a bit of a weird season for them. Just quickly on the Reds before we finish it, they're still in that, you know, they're in that battle, aren't they, for that final place. They've been on some good form lately, but just didn't get it going really last night. And it was always going to be one of those situations. Just got a couple of side notes, Chris, before we finish.
Go on, mate.
Your goal of the week, who have you given it to?
I'm going to give it to Gashi.
The free kick?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm with you, definitely. The absolutely brilliant.
Tasserman. The chip runs in a close second.
Bedoya, not the boy.
Yeah.
Bedoya. It was a fantastic goal. Gerardo Tata Martino, the former Argentina manager who Messi didn't like, has been named as Atlanta United manager for
Atlanta
next season.
Atlanta United.
Start next season, and a lot of people are excited by it. Some others not so excited by it, but I guess that's what it's all about. But this, Chris, this is the one really. First of all, my team, Orlando City, have sold 18,000 season tickets for their new stadium. That's the cap. It's done. Only old 25,500, so well done, Lions. I'm not surprised. The only thing is they got the second highest average attendance in MLS of 32,000. And the stadium's 25,500.
Madness, mate.
Bit mad. But anyway,
you did a video on this earlier in the year.
We did, but still a bit mad. That is more I wanted to ask you about. Last weekend, Fox done a mixed day. So it was MLS and NFL. It was a big station giving MLS a real push, which hasn't really happened, I'm led to believe. They had Rachel Bonetta doing an advert. It's always a winner when Rachel Bonetta's on it, doing a little thing where there was two of them. She had NLF top on, she had MLS, and they were doing that to get the excitement going. But the games just followed each other, and there was an audience of just under 1.3 million viewers, which is the biggest telecast of MLS for 12 years. So,
wow.
Great that they're trying to dovetail them together and create that.
That's it. I mean, I think what MLS have lacked is a focus, you know. I'm a massive NFL fan, but
yeah.
NFL fans' week is built around a Sunday.
Right,
you know, you know exactly what you're doing because, you know, 90% of the games are on a Sunday. They have like six games and then seven games or something like that, and then a later game once again.
Okay.
So all day you could sit and watch 9 hours of NFL. What do families do?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And there's no space in there. Another hour and a half worth of football or something like soccer, you know what I mean? So they need somewhere at home and somewhere to live and somewhere to integrate themselves into American people's lives. And until they can do that, they're going to have a massive struggle. So it's good to see these baby steps.
Yeah,
I think that's what they are, mate. I think, you know, even look at baseball, goes on every other bloody night.
Yeah,
you know, you can watch baseball whenever you want. Yeah. You know when basketball's on.
The
NFL,
same.
You know when that is. It's Sunday now, they've got Thursday nights, they've got a Monday game and all that as well. But they need a home for MLS, and I'm really happy to hear that they've done that.
Yeah, I think their numbers are brilliant because, like I say, the biggest thing, and hopefully this is just the steps going forward now for making soccer great in the United States. Anyway, let us know what you think in the comments section below. Anything about the games that we talked about, any of the side points we talked about, what should we be talking about? Me and Chris will be back next week. We'll see if the other fellow with the beard will join us as well. Take it easy, and we'll see you next time on the MLS Show. Ha ha.